status of the Passover, lives and reigns forever.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be raised high and greatly exalted. Even as many were amazed at him, so marred was his look beyond human semblance, and his appearance beyond that of the sons of man. So shall he startle many nations. Because of him, the kings shall stand speechless. For those who have not been told shall see. Those who have not heard shall ponder. Who would believe what we have heard? To whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Grew up like a sapling before him, like a shoot from the parched earth. There was in him no stately bearing to make us look at him, nor appearance would attract us to him. He was spurned and avoided by people, a man of suffering, accustomed to infirmity, one of those from whom people hid their faces, spurned, and we held him in no esteem. Yet it was our infirmities that he bore, our sufferings that he endured. While we thought of him as stricken, as one smitten by God and afflicted, but he was pierced for our offenses, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. We had all gone astray like sheep, each following his own way. But the Lord laid upon him the guilt of us all. Though he was harshly treated, he submitted and opened not his mouth. Like a lamb led to the slaughter, or a sheep before the shearers, he was silent and opened not his mouth. Oppressed and condemned, he was taken away. And who would have thought any more of his destiny? He was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people. A grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with the evildoers. Though he had done no wrong, nor spoken any falsehood, but the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life. The will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in the fullness of days. Through his suffering, my servant shall justify many, and their guilt he shall bear. Therefore, I will give him his portion among the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the mighty. Because he surrendered himself to death and was counted among the wicked. And he shall take away the sins of many and win pardon for their offenses. The word of the Lord.
Amen. pass through the heavens. Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered. And when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord. So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was high priest that year. It was Caiaphas who had counseled the Jews that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid, who was the gatekeeper, said to Peter,
"You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?"
He said,
"I am not."
Now the Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him,
"I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogue or in the temple area where all the Jews gather. And in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me what I said to them. They know what I said."
When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said,
"Is this the way you answer the high priest?"
Jesus answered him,
"If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?"
Then Annas sent him down to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him, "He denied it and said,
I am not."
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said, "Again, Peter denied it." And immediately the cock crowed. Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning. And they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so that they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said,
"What charge do you bring against this man?"
They answered and said to him, At this, Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves, the judge him according to your law."
The Jews answered him,
"We do not have
the right to execute anyone." In order that the word of Jesus might be that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him,
"Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered,
"You say this on your own, or have others told you about me?"
Pilate answered,
"I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?"
Jesus answered,
"My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here."
So Pilate said to him,
"Then you are a king."
Jesus answered,
"You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice."
Pilate said to him,
"What is truth?"
When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them,
"I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?"
They cried out again,
"Not this one,
but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers rolled a crown out of thorns and placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came out to him and said,
"Hail, King of the Jews."
And they struck him repeatedly. Once more Pilate went out and said to them,
"Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him."
So Jesus came out, wearing a crown of thorns and a purple cloak, and he said to them,
"Behold the man."
When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out,
"Crucify him! Crucify him!"
Pilate said to them,
"Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him."
The Jews answered,
"We have a law, and according to that law, we crucify him. Let us make himself the Son of God."
Now, when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus,
"Where are you from?"
Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to him,
"Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and that I have power to crucify you?"
Jesus answered him,
"You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin."
Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, But the Jews cried out,
"If you release him, you are out of the Caesar. Everyone makes us out of the king, opposed to Caesar."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was the preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews,
"Behold your king."
They cried out,
"Take him away, crucify him."
Pilate said to them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but Caesar."
Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and carried the cross himself. He went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew, Golgotha. There he crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek. So the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews, but as it said, I am the King of the Jews."
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from top down. So they said to one another,
"Let's not tear it, let's not tear it, see who's in the tunic."
In order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, "They divided my garments among them. For my vesture they cast lots." This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother,
"Woman, behold your son."
Then he said to the disciple,
"Behold your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said,
"I thirst."
There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit. Another passage says, "They will look upon him whom they have pierced." After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate granted it. So he came and took the body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb, in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, but the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It's the meeting place of Christ, the bride, and his church, the bridegroom. The very life of the church and his sacramental presence flows from these wounds. And it's there where we experience the heart of God in these wounds. We experience the heart of God in the face of mercy. The wounds of Jesus Christ are the bridge that connects God and man, opening our hearts to the hope of being loved despite our sinfulness. It is there, rather than being a sign of weakness, it's the mark of his all-powerfulness. And it's there in those wounds. It's there in those wounds that you and I find life. We heard in Isaiah where he was pierced for our offenses, pierced, crushed for our sins. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. Upon him was the chastisement that makes us whole. By his stripes we were healed. The wounds of our Savior is where the weak, the sinful, the broken, the fallen, the suffering, the hurting, and who knows
those wells can find a place of firm security and peace. And indeed, the more we can find security there, in those wounds, the more Jesus can do to help us. In other words, Jesus' wounds are a place, they're a place of receptivity for us. They're not just something, they're not something to look at with horror. There's something to gaze upon with deep faith and trust and hope and love. Knowing that by those wounds we have been healed is a place of receptivity for us. He heals the brokenhearted and binds up their wounds. You know, St. Faustina wrote in her diary that Jesus told her these words: "When it seems to you that your suffering exceeds your strength, when it seems to you that your suffering exceeds your strength," Jesus said, "contemplate my wounds." Sister Maria of the Crucified Love, she was a 20th century German Carmelite mystic. She was given this revelation from the Lord, and she wrote it in her diary, in her book. "Where will you turn to when in the coming time the difficulties grow still greater? My sacred wounds will be your surest refuge. Nowhere are you better protected." How beautiful is that? How beautiful is that? As I said earlier, the wounds of Jesus are a rendezvous place with the bride and the bridegroom. Think about this. Now, when your children come to you with an album, they come to you in their suffering, right? Isn't that correct? What do? You kiss their wounds and make it better, don't you? The crying stops, the tears stop flowing, all is better. This place of union with Jesus is where we place our hurts, where we place our sufferings, where we place our disappointments, where we place our sins. We place them into the wounds of Jesus. We push them into the side of Christ. We push them into the side of Christ, where our wounds are beating his wounds. By placing or pushing our small wounds into the great open wounds of Jesus, which stems from his great generosity and love, his wounds then heal us. So the cross of Jesus, where we see all the wounds exposed, is a place where you and I are invited to live most deeply. It is here, united with Jesus, where we are most loved and most cherished. In fact, it is from the cross where Jesus thirsts for our faith and for our love of those for whom he has given up his whole life. So the cross of Jesus must be claimed by each of us. It has to be claimed by us. I mean, it was given to us in baptism, but we have to claim it, whereby we have the opportunity to offer our suffering for the end of the human injustice, for the many persecuted for their faith, for those many faithful martyrs in our world today who have truly embraced the cross, for the men and women and children worn out and fearful who flee from war and violence, and who often only find death. It's a place where we offer Jesus that suffering, the suffering of the world. But Christ also sends us into the world to enter into the wounds of others, wherever we find ourselves, and to whomever Christ sends us. We cannot be afraid to enter into the wounds of others in order to bring love there, to bring Christ's love there. This is our call. You know, Father Campbell Mason, he's a preacher of the papal household. He recently said in a talk, he said the temptation of imperfect lovers, that's us, imperfect lovers. He said the temptation of imperfect lovers in the face of the cross and the wounds of Christ, namely, is to want to be able to say yes once and get it over with. And so get on the pleasant receiving side of things again. But he said this misses the point in that love by its very nature, he said, this is a powerful word, is holocaustal. Love by its nature is holocaustal. It is total and constant giving of self to God. Because it is in giving that we receive. Pope Benedict in Deus Caritas says, he said, union with Jesus Christ. And I'm sure he meant on the cross. Is also a union with all those to whom he gives himself. He said, I cannot possess Christ just by for myself. I can belong to him only in union with all those who have become or who will become his own. Jesus gave us a mandate last night. I give you a model to follow so that as I have done for you, you should also do. So do this in memory. My dear friends, in the end, our lives make absolutely no sense apart from the cross of Jesus Christ and his wounds. On the cross, the very heart of God is displayed for all the world to see. The very heart of God is displayed for all the world to see. Jesus surrendered it all, and by his wounds, we are healed. This love never stops being available to us. It's always inviting us into union with Jesus. Because it is there where the meaning of our lives can be found, in his wounds, by which you and I have been healed. So today, as we come forward to reverence the cross of Jesus, let us confidently approach this throne of grace, entering his wounds to receive mercy.
Let us pray also for our most holy. Promise on Abraham. Let us hear.
Thank you. Thank you.
At the Savior's command, formed by divine teaching, we dare to say,
Thank you.
us the work of your mercy, that by partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow down and bless.
May abundant blessing, O Lord, be great, descend upon your people, who have honored the death of your Son and the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure, through Christ our Lord.
Thank you.